Good morning. You guys have a great energy, and I'm super happy to be here with you this morning. I normally like to talk for an hour or so to get all my message out, and I don't have that much time this morning, so I'm going to rush, and I'm going to keep it moving. I am probably one of the more real drug abuse speakers you're going to see. Sometimes I go to school, and the principal's eyes get real big when they see what I talk about and some of the images I'm going to show you guys. But you're young adults. You're not kids. You're not babies. And you're living in a world where you're being put in situations where you have to make real adult decisions. Even children much younger, you know, middle school and elementary school, are having to make some really tough decisions in life. So I'm going to talk about the reality of drug abuse. Everything I'm going to show you comes from my life experience. Now, I've never used an illegal drug. When I was 6 or 7, I wanted to be a soldier or a spy or a cop. That was my dream. But when I was at Parker, at the parties, people offered me weed. When I was in 10th grade at Parker, they offered me cocaine. Some of those parties, I was the only one who didn't use. And I felt pressured, and I felt tempted. I felt like an outsider. But I always remembered, you know what? And I knew early, drug abuse, using drugs is never going to get me where I want to go. I don't need to know what it's like. I already knew it wasn't going to help me. You guys all know using drugs is not going to help you get places. Right? But even though I'd never used a drug, I got a job with the DEA when I was 23, the Drug Enforcement Administration. If you don't know what that is, it's a federal agency just like the FBI. I have all the same legal authorities as an FBI agent, the same pay, the same training. But the DEA does one thing, drug enforcement. We investigate the people making drugs, smuggling drugs, selling drugs, and moving the money with drugs. In 28 years as a DEA agent, I have seen constantly what drugs do to individuals and their families and their communities and their schools and even other countries. And I developed this presentation to show you that reality, the best that I can to show you that reality. Now, you may guess that I'm a patriotic guy. I love our country. I'm super proud that I swore an oath to uphold the Constitution. I take that very seriously. Right? But as patriotic as I am, as much as I love our country, there are things going on in our country that make me upset about us. And this for me is number one. In spite of all our freedom, in spite of being so rich, so full of opportunities, we are the biggest drug-using country on the planet, by far. We use the most drugs, we spend the most money on drugs, we have the most drug addicts, we have the most people dying from drugs, the most drug-addicted babies. In all these categories, we are number one. And it honestly doesn't make sense. But there it is. And I'm going to explain some realities to you. And I'll start with this one. Even buying drugs, never mind what it does to you personally, because I'll talk about that. But even buying drugs causes harm. I'm going to pick on you. What's your name?
Kai.
Kai?
Yeah.
Okay. We're going to pick on Kai. And we're going to pretend that this weekend, Kai's going to go to a party. And he wants to be the cool kid to bring some cocaine to the party. So he asks around, he finds out that I'm the guy that sells coke up here. He finds me with $100, I sell him a few grams of coke, we both leave happy. Did I manufacture that cocaine that I sold here in Carmel Valley? No, where did it come from? Colombia, South America, Bolivia, Peru. So to get my cocaine, I give his $100 to him, and I buy more. And he gives it to him, who gives it to him, who gives it to him, who gives it to her. And she's the one that has all the contacts with the cartels down in TJ. And the drug guys in TJ committing all that violence. How many of you are aware of all the violence going on in Tijuana right now? Raise your hands. It's a terrible, scary place to live right now. But she takes Kai's $100 from Carmel Valley and puts it in the hands of the traffickers in Tijuana, who use his money to pay the hitmen and the assassins. But they didn't make the cocaine there, so she has to send the money on down to her, who has all the gang connections in El Salvador. And she puts Kai's $100 in the hands of the MS-13 gang in El Salvador that kills my cop friends every day. And then finally, she sends the money down to him because he's got all the contacts down in Bogota. And Kai's $100 ends up down in Colombia killing cops. Our country is full of people who do not care who they hurt with drugs, themselves, their families, or the money they put in the hands of the criminals. There are three laws. There are three laws when it comes to drug abuse. First, it always starts as a choice. You all know this. It starts as a choice. You're at the party, you're at your friend's house, you're at the beach, someone you know, someone you think you look up to, someone you like comes up and says, hey, look what I got, let's do this. Come on, come on, because that's what happened to me. It's what's happened to my kids, and it's happened to you. And you all know in that little moment, you have a small decision to make. Yes or no? It's not a big decision. It's a yes or no. It's not complicated. But when your friend is pressuring you, it's hard. It starts with a choice. Second, people who choose to put themselves on the path of abusing drugs always suffer negative consequences. Some drugs are harsher than others. Marijuana will not treat you the same way that heroin will treat you, but there are consequences of smoking a bunch of weed, and I'll talk about that. This is what we see in our world. You may know friends who use a lot of dope and brag about it and are doing great in school and they're great athletes. And you're like, wow, they're using, Rocky says it's dangerous, but he's using drugs, he's doing great. Yeah, right now, at 17, 18, mom and dad are paying all the bills, his body's young and healthy. When do you think I meet him? I meet him 10 years from now, when he's selling dope or committing crimes and his life's destroyed because of the choices he began making back in high school. It's always your choice to begin with. There's always consequences. And third, and the most important and worst, those negative consequences never ever just affect the users. They affect them, for sure, their families, their friends, their community, their school, and even other countries. And I'm gonna pick on Kai again. And this happened 3 times last month in San Diego. 3 people last month in San Diego died from using cocaine that had another drug called fentanyl mixed into it. So let's pretend that the cocaine I sold Kai had fentanyl. Kai goes home, tries it out, and dies. Happened 3 times in San Diego last month. Did Kai's death just affect Kai? No. His family's devastated, his friends are devastated, his teachers, his school, you guys would be devastated. This is all real stuff, but you're being sold a bunch of lies. You're being sold some BS. My daughters are 23, 20, and 18 right now. And I've tried to be a good dad, and I've tried to pay attention to what my daughters have been exposed to, what they've been watching in the movies and TV shows, and the music videos, and it's crap. You're being told every day, almost everything you watch, drug use is cool. Everyone does it, it's normal, it's part of being young. Come on, you need to know what it's like. Now, they don't say in the movie, drug use is cool. They don't do it that way. They just show you over and over and over again all these scenes of these beautiful young people having the best time of their life, stoned on whatever it is. That's what you see over and over and over again. Another message you guys get, drugs don't hurt anybody. Oh, Rocky's lying to you. Your counselors are lying to you, your parents are lying to you, you're strong, nothing's gonna happen to you. They're just making these worst case scenarios up. You guys get this message, you've always gotten this message. And I'm gonna talk about this little boy. This is from Ohio from a couple years ago. This little 4-year-old's riding around town with his dad and the dad's girlfriend in the car. Dad and the girlfriend are heroin users. They inject heroin in the car in front of the boy. And they keep driving around. As sadly too often happens, she injected too much heroin and she accidentally goes into an overdose, starts to die in the car. Her boyfriend driving the car panics, tries to get her to the hospital to save her when he starts to overdose and he passes out. The vehicle goes out of control, almost hits a school bus, stops in the middle of the street. That little 4-year-old boy, surrounded by police officers and strangers, thinks his dad's dead right in front of him, thinks the girlfriend's dead right in front of him, and yet, you don't see any emotion on his face, do you? And when I first found this unpixelated picture, because I had to search hard for it, that shocked me. How could a 4-year-old in that nightmare not have fear or shock or some sadness and something in his face? And I came to a conclusion. That's his normal. He's used to it. That's the only explanation I can come up with. He's used to seeing his dad like that. That's a little boy in our country. Wasn't his choice to use drugs, wasn't his decision, sure as hell was his consequence. He's suffering. And if he's that badly damaged at 4 years old, how is he gonna grow up emotionally? What kind of a person, human being, parent is he gonna be? Another story kills me. This young mom lived in Philadelphia with her baby. Also a heroin user. Shoots up one night in bed, accidentally kills herself from an overdose. 3 weeks later, the police open the apartment and they find baby Philip dead in bed next to her. They discover that he died of dehydration, which, in case you don't know, is a very slow and agonizing death. And if that weren't bad enough, when the detectives did their job and interviewed the neighbors, not one, but several neighbors said, oh yeah, a few weeks ago we heard a couple nights of screaming and crying, but then it stopped. So little Philip, as he lay dying, begging and screaming for help, begging and screaming for someone to come save him, even the people that heard him did not pick up the phone. That's a little boy in your country. And these are not worst case scenarios. Sometimes kids say, oh, this is just the worst case. I can't show you the worst case, guys. I can't show you the pictures of how we find these people. I can only talk about it. And these events are happening every day in our country, and they're increasing. This 20-year-old girl in Texas, this happened this year. I met two drug dealers in San Diego, I arrested them, who told me that they sold weed, but they weren't making enough money. So they put meth into the joints without telling their customers, selling to young people, to get them hooked on meth. Because once someone's hooked on meth, they'll give their drug dealer anything, their bodies, they'll steal, they'll commit crimes. This girl in Texas, somebody gave her a joint with meth in it. She got hooked on meth. She decided she liked it, started using meth until one day she had a bad trip, stood outside of a church and gouged out her eyeballs in the middle of the day. And she tells her story now. She wants you to hear her story. Everybody I'm going to show you in my presentation today, once upon a time, was in high school with a healthy body and a healthy mind and dreams of a life they wanted to live. Every single person in my presentation. And yet every single person in my presentation, in that little moment of decision, come on, come on, come on, they went, okay. Totally convinced to themselves, convincing themselves at that moment that nothing bad was going to happen to them. And yet today they're in my presentation. These two moms met in rehab in Florida, got cleaned up, right? Got cured. And then they found him shortly afterwards, OD'd in their car with the babies in the car seats in the back seat. This guy was a pilot for Spirit Airlines, one of the more prestigious jobs in our country. Their children wake up in the morning, find mom and dad dead in bed from a drug OD. This little boy wakes up to get his parents, thinks they're dead, 5 years old, runs down the street begging for help. Somebody comes and saves his parents. This is happening every day in our country. This mom goes to Walmart with her daughter, a little shopping trip. Uses dope in the parking lot, ODs in the Walmart. You see a little toddler tugging at her mommy's arm? The video is quite something to watch. Little toddler begging and whimpering, trying to wake her mommy up. I've spoken to almost 80,000 young people in 7 countries with this presentation. And I have young people that challenge me. With all their wisdom and life experience of 15, 16, 17, they come up and challenge me and say, I'm full of it. Because they know, they've used everything and they're fine. They know nothing bad's going to happen to them. That's what they tell themselves, and they tell me, and they tell you, and they tell the world. But I'm here to share something with you. It does not matter how strong you are, how smart you think you are, how badass or cool you think you are. Your brain is fragile. Drugs are chemicals that we put in our bodies to change how our brains work. You are not stronger than the drugs. I'm tougher than I look. I have survived some really ugly experiences in life. I do not believe I'm stronger than drugs, and I'm never going to put myself to the test. I don't need to find out. It's hitting every community. It's hitting every community. Every part of our country is being attacked. I've met these poor immigrant families. They accomplished their dream of bringing their families to the United States, coming from places where the society doesn't tell their kids to use drugs. And their children start using and become addicted and die. And the parents never had a clue they were living in a world, in a culture, that said this was okay. I'm not a big fan of statistics, because people can twist statistics. But death numbers are kind of hard to argue with. They are what they are. When I started in DEA back in 1990, we had about 10,000 people a year dying from drugs. I thought that was a big number. When I started talking to schools in 2007, it was 35,000. Last year it was 72,000. Up from 64,000 the year before. I'm predicting 80,000 this year. That's a hideous number. That's more than could fit in Qualcomm Stadium, dying every year from their choice to use drugs. And for everyone who dies from an OD, there are dozens more who don't die, who suffer on in their addiction. And for everyone who suffers in addiction, there are dozens more people trying to love them, trying to get them to stop. But drug addicts don't want to stop. You'll hear that, oh, he wants to stop, or she wants to stop. No, they don't. They've changed their brains. Their brains tell them, give me my drug, give me my drug. That's what their life becomes about. Drug abuse does not care what your skin color is, what your language is, where you come from. We're all human beings, we all suffer equally, and we're suffering a lot. You guys have studied some history. I'm trying to get my mind around these numbers. So I compared some death numbers. I looked at the 4 biggest wars in the 20th century. those 19 years of bloody conflict in the 20th century, we lost 634,000 soldiers, an incredible number. The last 19 years, we've lost 700,000 people to ODs, and it's increasing. The question I have for you, for everybody, is when do we start to care? How many people have to die every year for us to actually go, wait a second, time out, let's rethink this. What's wrong with our culture? What's wrong with our young people that so many of them want to start doing this? Does it have to be 100,000, quarter million? I don't know. But I do know that I can throw out a number to you, and it's just a big number. What does it mean? So I made a video. I picked about 40 pictures off the internet, randomly off the internet, of people who died from overdoses. You're gonna see their name, their age, the drug or drugs that killed them. Some of them are famous, some are young, some are older. I have a request for you. As you watch this video, listen to the words of the song, it's sad too, and look at the eyes and the smiles of these people. And think about the fact that every single one of them, in that moment of decision, come on, brother, come on, cousin, come on, buddy, let's do this. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. They went, okay. Convinced nothing bad was gonna happen to them.
Oh.
I made that video, I've shown it hundreds of times, and I get choked up every time I watch it. Because I don't know anybody in that, but I know lots of families that lost their kids. Now, you guys may remember one of the pictures of a black guy, Len, the tie on. Most of you don't know the name Len Bias, but you should. 30 years ago, Len Bias was coming out of college basketball. He was the next Michael Jordan. He's a household name in this country. Everybody knew Len. Everybody was waiting to see Len get to the pros. He signed his pro contract for millions back then. And his friends threw him a party. And one of his friends, so excited for Len, came up and said, "Hey man, look what I got, let's do some coke." And Len went, "Okay." And did the coke and his heart stopped and he died. First time he ever used it. If you think you are stronger or more intelligent or more talented or somehow more able to resist the bad consequences of drug abuse than Len Bias or any of the people you just saw, I don't know what your basis for believing that is, because I don't believe it in myself. You guys live in scary times. I worry about my daughters, I worry about you guys. We did not have this problem a few years ago. We didn't have people purposefully making fake drugs. We do now, because they make money. Those things look like oxycodone. They look exactly like oxycodone. I'm a professional, I can't tell them apart. But they came from a lab in Mexico. They contain a drug called fentanyl, the same drug that killed Prince. At a party in California a couple years ago, somebody showed up, "Hey, I got these Roxys, come on, take them. 10 people dead, because it wasn't Roxy. Some buddies of mine in Oakland DEA got some guys selling Xanax into the high schools, did an investigation. They seized 65,000 Xanax from a garage where they were making them. They bought a machine off the internet. Those pills looked exactly like Xanax, but they weren't. I don't know what was in them, but it wasn't Xanax. But when it shows up at the party, "Come on, I got these Xanax, I got these Z-bars, come on. You guys think, "Oh, Xanax, that's not that bad. I know my mom's prescribed it, whatever. It can't kill me, it can't hurt me." A couple years ago, you're right. A couple years ago, Xanax wouldn't have killed you. Today, in your reality, not mine, your now and your future, that's what's showing up. The cell phone has changed the world for everybody, and it's changed it for you guys in a big, big way that we as parents and we as teachers don't understand. When I was a kid, my dad locked the door at night, the outside world stayed outside. We had one phone. If I wanted to ask a girl on a date, I had to get sweaty palms and dial her and actually talk to her and ask her on a date and get shot down in person. You guys ask for dates on texting, you get shot down over texting. It's changed your relationships. A lot of young people now don't have real friends. They've got tons of social media friends. They don't have real ones. They don't know how to communicate in a real way. When they hit a hard spot in life, something bad happens, they don't know where to go with it. You're getting exposed information on the phones that you're not telling anybody about. You're having to figure it out on your own. You guys may have seen this video on YouTube. These girls are on spring break somewhere drinking, being stupid, but having a good time, just trying to enjoy themselves. And then they watched the video and they found that. That is a really, I want to use a bad word now, bad guy, putting a drug in their drink with one purpose, to rape them. There they are having a good time, just having fun, and some guy comes up attempting to rape them. For me, rape's as bad as murder. So you live in a world where you can't even go to the beach or the party without being a little bit worried about what you're doing, who's around you. You have to think. We did not have this a couple years ago. That's a penny to show you the tiny amount of fentanyl that'll kill an adult human being. If I had it on my fingertip, you couldn't see it. That much of this drug will kill an adult, and it's showing up in everything. Xanax, the fake Ambien, the fake ecstasy, cocaine. We used to tell our kids, we used to lie to our kids and exaggerate, "Oh, you've messed around with drugs once, it'll ruin your life." That was kind of a lie and an exaggeration 5 years ago. Not a lie anymore. It's the reality that you guys are living in. And this is what I want you to please pay attention to. When a pharmaceutical company manufactures a pill, they take something like sugar, mannitol. It's called a binder. It's what gives the pill some size and bulk. Then they mix in a little bit of the drug or the chemical, whatever they want in the pill. If it's done in a pharmaceutical company, the two things are blended. in a scientific way by people who are trained, so that when they produce the pills, they know exactly how much of the drug is in each of the pills. When it comes out of Rocky's garage, Rocky the drug dealer's garage, and I'm making the pills, I don't know how to blend it properly. I make the pills, some of the pills have none of the drug, some have a little bit, and some have enough to kill a horse. I don't know which ones are deadly when I make them. The people I sell them to don't know which ones are deadly. The people they sell them to don't know they're deadly. The only time we find out they're deadly is after they've shown up at the party you guys are going to, and someone's died from taking it. And these are not big Hollywood dramatic deaths. The people that take these, they just die. And frequently, their friends don't even know anything happened. They're sitting on the sofa. What's your name?
Chase
is sitting on the sofa. Hey, man, it's late. I got to get home. My parents are going to be pissed. Hey, Chase, wake up. Hey, Chase, wake up. And he didn't wake up. These are pills we seized in San Diego and some spice we seized in San Diego doing undercover cases. This is what it looked like. This is what the dope dealer said it was. This is what our laboratory in Vista found out that it was. The addicted babies. I've been doing this job 28 years. Parts of the job I hate. I hate the paperwork. I hate the bureaucracy. I hate the bad bosses that I have sometimes. But I am as motivated today as a DEA agent as I was 28 years ago, because once in a while, if I do my job right, I get to arrest the guys and the girls selling these poisons, causing this harm. You guys are going to a fantastic school. You're an incredibly well-informed group of young people. And yet you don't know that every year in this country, more than 30,000 babies are born to their mothers addicted to heroin or the opioid pills they were taking during pregnancy. I'm not talking about the crack babies and the meth babies and the fetal alcohol syndrome babies and the marijuana babies, and there's tens or hundreds of thousands more of them. I'm just talking about the heroin and opioid babies. And incredibly, when we or doctors discover these pregnant moms, the doctors have to keep drugging the mom all the way through the pregnancy. Because if they stop drugging the mom, and you guys all know everything the mom takes goes into the baby. So the baby's a drug addict as well. If the mother stops getting the drug, she'll go into drug withdrawal, which is a horrible illness, incredibly painful and damaging to the body. If the mother goes in drug withdrawal, so will the fetus inside her, and the fetus might die or be badly damaged. So to give that baby the best chance of being born as healthy as it can be, we drug the mother all the way through the pregnancy, in your country, until the baby's born. Cut the umbilical cord, and that baby very quickly goes into the incredible agony of drug withdrawal. The first gift these young mothers give to their babies is that agony. The pain of it is so intense that the doctors have now decided to treat that pain in these innocent newborn babies with morphine, one of the most powerful painkillers ever invented. And just so you guys understand a little bit better, I do some work with wounded warriors here in San Diego. These young friends of mine, when they stepped on the landmines in Afghanistan and landed on the ground legless on the battlefield, their fellow soldiers come to them and give them what? Morphine. I need you to be paying attention and tracking right now. The same medicine that we give soldiers this badly wounded in combat, we are giving to more than 30,000 newborn babies every year in our country. And we're not talking about it. How are we not talking about this? How are we not all seeking a solution to this? And yet we're not. Who are we as a culture? Who are we as a country that this does not cause a reaction? I'll make an example. I know you guys care about the environment. You want clean air, clean oceans like I do. Let's pretend that you became aware that 30,000 baby dolphins a year were being born poisoned by something that we were putting in the oceans. I think you'd know about it. I think it'd be 24/7 on the news cycle. I think you'd be out protesting and marching and demanding that somebody save those baby dolphins. And you'd be right. I'd support you. But 30,000 baby Americans born like this, and we don't even talk about it. I graduated Francis Parker in 85, Pomona College in 89. In 1990, incredibly, the DEA offered me a job. You may not believe this, but I had hair back then. I had long hair and a big red beard. And I would pretend to be a rich college kid because that's what I looked like. I can't do that anymore, but that's what I used to do. Buying drugs, selling drugs. I get paid 5 days a week, I worked seven. I loved my job. There's plenty of traffickers to chase. I was good at my job, And in 1998, the DEA sent me down to Bolivia. And I lived in Bolivia for 6 years, working with cops like these guys. You can see how well I fit in down there. Doing the thing about cocaine. Now, when I went to Washington, before I went to Bolivia, I was told, Rocky, you're going down there to solve their problem. We're sending you to Bolivia to help you solve their problem. But as I spent those 6 years going out in the jungle with these guys, searching for these drug labs, dangerous work, all day, every day, for 6 years, it changed me. Because I realized, no, it's not their problem. All that environmental damage, the corruption, the violence, the poverty that I was fighting in Bolivia is our problem, because it's paid for by Americans who don't care who they hurt, even buying their drugs. Bolivians don't want to raise their kids in a drug country, but they can't help it, because we don't care who we hurt with our money. I've done big cases. I've done things that belong in movies. I've done stuff I can't talk about. I'm happy to have the pictures, and I'm happy I survived all that. In April, I was sent down to El Salvador on a crazy mission. I was sent to talk to kids in the MS-13 neighborhoods. I was sent to talk to their kids with the same message. I speak Spanish. Americans do not go where I went. Americans do not go where I went. The government gave me this low-key security team. That's how worried they were about my security. And these boys followed me everywhere, even in the bathroom. A guy would walk in with a rifle. Now, please don't ask me why I went to get a haircut one day. That would be cruel to ask me that. But I went to get a haircut one day, and they went with me. And I love this picture because you can see the joy on the face of my barber having my security detail. But I'm very proud that I get to do this. And what's amazing is those MS-13 kids are receiving the same message as you guys are. They're being encouraged to use drugs. They know what's wrong, and they want information. And then I'm proud of this. Last month in Tijuana, I spoke to 1,300 college kids. People told me that's impossible. They're going to hate you. You're an American cop. They hate Trump. They hate the wall. They hate all this stuff. You know what? I went down there, and I did it. And that's 1,300 college kids in Tijuana cheering for the DEA. That's impossible. But I made it happen. Not because I'm so talented or handsome or gifted, but because my message is human. My message is real, and it applies to them and to you and the kids in Colombia and the kids in El Salvador. I always talk about Camarena. Enrique Camarena was a DEA agent working in Guadalajara back in 85 when I was graduating from Parker. Doing a good job. Made the traffickers in Guadalajara angry. They kidnapped him. They tortured him for a couple days. They dumped him dead on the side of the road. It outraged us as a country. The Mexican government wouldn't help us, so we closed the border for 2 days to send them a message. And it started the whole Red Ribbon movement. It had a lot to do with me joining the DEA, and I'm always proud to touch on his memory. I have my three girls. I don't know you guys, right? But I worry about you. I worry about the world you live in. I worry about the people out there trying to get you to make bad choices and to make bad decisions. You alone choose your futures. Your parents have given you an amazing start by sending you here. You won the lottery to go to this school. I won the lottery to go to Francis Parker and Pomona College. I recognize that. I hope you recognize the lottery you won to be here. Respect that. Respect the chances you have. Because at the end of the day, I'm a cop. You know, what am I do? I can arrest drug traffickers and seize their drugs and seize their money. I'm good at it. I totally believe in it. But the problem is, as long as you guys are willing to buy their drugs, there will always be drug traffickers. Everyone I arrest, two more are going to stand up to get the money, to get your money. Every 1,000 pounds of drugs we see, someone's going to make 1,000 pounds more to get the money. What I do is important. I believe in it, but it's never going to stop this. The solution to all this pain and misery and suffering I'm talking about today is something so simple and elegant, and it's sitting in every row here today. You guys are the solution. If I could somehow magically get each and every one of you to respect your health and your brains and your dreams and your futures, you would never put this stuff in your bodies. But as simple and obvious as that sounds, it is proving impossible in our society. Because too many young people don't listen, they think they know better. And they gamble with everything. Not everybody who starts using drugs suffers these consequences. But nobody knows before they start if they're going to be the one that suffers the consequences. We can talk about the party that happens in the movie, That's real, that happens, everybody gets high. But what you don't see is what comes afterwards. 90% of the property crime in this country is some drug addict stealing your stuff, breaking into your house, mugging you to get money to get their drugs. Even at this school, some of you know young people living in poverty because one or both of their parents are drunks or alcoholics and there's no money for the kids or for the family. And the kids suffer that way. Some of you know young people living in terrible broken home situations, neglected by their parents because one or both are alcoholics or addicts. And those young people have to raise themselves their entire childhood. And like me, some of you know young people who've been beaten by their own parents because mom gets angry when she gets drunk or dad gets angry when he can't get high. I spoke at a middle school in San Diego 2 days ago and a 12-year-old girl came up to me crying, confessing, and her mom threatens to beat her up every night. That's the reality of this stuff. The party happens. It's what comes afterwards that's so hideous.
Something a nervous habit, and I'll play with their hair. Me, I do this, when I'm nervous, I search around for like little shaving bumps or whatever, little blackheads or whatever. Even if they're not there when I'm high, I can feel the slightest little, even a pore, you know, try to pinch some out of it. And after you pinch the skin, it's irritated, so it's falling a little bit, and the next time I'm gonna have it, then it's a real problem. Oh, there must be something, pinch, my hands are dirty, so I cause an infection. When I'm high, I don't really realize I'm doing it, all stuff turns it. People have to tell me, hey, stop doing it, oh, fuck, I didn't realize I was doing it. And then a little while later, I'll start doing it again. It's bad, and this is what happens. Impetigo, you know, surface infections. And this is only 7 days of being on the street. 7 days of being on the street. I was clean and sober for 4 months. No alcohol, no drugs, not even Tylenol. You know, working a good program, having a good relationship with God, spirituality. Giving back, helping out other people that are needing help, you know, giving back to the addict who still suffers. And my addiction is based on my shame and all my sorrow from the past experience, my childhood, the stuff that I haven't dealt with, that really just kind of stuffed back into the back of my mind. It comes out and it manifests as shame, embarrassment, low self-esteem, low self-worth. I'm always feeling like people are judging me, so I need to get high. When I get high, I feel power and I feel strong. Nobody can touch me, and it alters my mind, and I don't worry about the past. My brain is so fuzzy, all I can really do is focus on the moment rather than the past or the future. That's the payoff, and that's why I do it. It's running, though. It's so bad. You know, it's running from your responsibilities and what you need to do and be as a man. That really, really, it's so that makes me want to get high again to forget how I'm creating this dilemma. Like, it's a paradox, saying I'm creating the thing that makes me want to do what I'm doing. By using the dope, it's ruining my life to make me want to do the dope. So it's a catch 22. And I know that if I was to get clean and stay clean long enough, it would be a payoff that way too, but I'm just used to the quick payoff. I want the payoff now, I want the satisfaction now, and that's what drugs does for me. If I had some kind of patience and perseverance for any amount of time, I would start seeing the change in my life, staying clean and sober. But I just get so the overwhelming of the emotions when I come into early recovery is too much for me to handle. I start to cry all the time. I'm angry. I don't end up communicating. I get frustrated. I don't feel like I'm liked. I feel isolated, you know, apart from everybody else. And then I end up just leaving here without coming back down here where I'm comfortable. Like, this is like my family down here.
I've talked to a lot of drug addicts over the years. I've never heard anybody put it better than that guy. That is a very intelligent man. And he's almost poetic at talking about how he knows what he's doing, if he knows what his life would be like if he could stop, but he can't stop. And like everybody else I'm showing you, the first time he started using, he was convinced that he could walk away from it. And now he's living in the gutter with his family. I'm gonna go pretty quickly through these pictures. These are just pictures of some of the cases that I've done over the years. Show you how ingenious the traffickers are. I've seen this a couple times on the border here. Hire a young girl to put that on and walk drugs across the border. It works. This I'll talk about. This is a 25-year-old guy from Colombia. Wanted to get somewhere like the U.S. or Spain where he could have some opportunities. Some traffickers offered him a plane ticket and a passport and some money and a chance to go live in Spain. All he needed to do was swallow those packages of cocaine. He went, okay. And he got on an airplane. Sadly for him, one of those things burst open and he died on the flight. Just died. He didn't suffer. When they got to Spain, they x-rayed his body. When I was in Bolivia one day working at the airport, this young guy was coming through security also with a ticket for Spain. But he was sweating and pale and clearly sick. I leaned over and I touched his stomach and it was like I was knocking on wood because the cocaine packages he'd swallowed had locked up inside him and he was dying. Bolivia does not have 911. I had to throw him in my DEA car and race him to the hospital. When I got to the hospital, the doctors refused to operate on him. I almost got in a fist fight with the doctors, threatening them to operate on this guy, which they did. And they pulled out 96 packages of cocaine the size of my thumb from his intestines. Now, most of these people don't die. They get to LA or San Diego or Miami or Madrid, wherever they're going. The traffickers take them to a motel. They sit them on buckets until they poop all that out. Then they can wash it off and repackage it to sell it to you guys. And then these young people who gave up all that risk to get a chance to have some of the opportunities that you do think they're free. No, they're not. These trafficking organizations push these young girls into prostitution, and the men are forced to sell drugs. And they're told if they don't go along, the traffickers will kill their families back home. That's happening here today because Americans don't care who they hurt buying the drugs they put in their bodies. Meth comes in these pretty crystals. I don't have time to talk, and I'm running out of time, but I'll talk about meth for a moment. It comes in these pretty crystals. This is what's in it. Hey. This is what's in it. The crystals look clean. The person that offers you the drug will always say it's good and it's safe. No matter what it is, the person who offers you the drug will look you in the eye and say this is good and safe. But you need to understand that person's lying to you. They don't know what's in it. They didn't make it. Even the people that make it don't know what's in it. These are the users of meth before and after they've used. These are real pictures. Everybody's somebody's child, somebody's brother, sister, parent. And they look this way over years and they keep using and they keep using and they see themselves and they tell themselves, oh, I gotta stop this because it's gonna kill me. And then their brain says, oh no, give me more drug. The drug they take to feel like Superman to get that high leaves them looking like this. Their mouths are just lovely. They don't go to the dentist for this. They go in their bathroom, they pluck their teeth and they keep using the drug. These are what the labs look like. This is how we find them. There's no cleanliness there. There's no quality control. None of you guys would eat food that came from those kitchens. And yet young people just as smart as you guys are totally willing to put the chemicals that come from those filthy places into their veins. When we go, we wear spacesuits. These places are so toxic, we go in spacesuits with our own oxygen. I'll talk about marijuana. Everybody's favorite subject right now. It's legal, Rocky. It's medicine, Rocky. Okay, let's talk about the medicine thing. I have young people telling me, hey man, it's medicine, it helps people with cancer. And I'm like, okay, to the 15-year-old or 16-year-old telling me that. If it helps somebody with cancer, guys, God bless them. That's not something I care about as a DEA agent. But if you at 15 or 16 or 17 are gonna tell me the reason you smoke it is because it's medicine for people with cancer, that's not logic. That is not an argument. That's someone rationalizing, making a reason to justify what they're doing. This really bothers me. You're being told it's herbal. You're being told it's going to make you more creative, more relaxed, whatever it is you're being told. You're not being told it's addictive. This is the DSM manual produced by American psychologists and psychiatrists with every mental disorder they can think of. When you go to the marijuana section, they have this nice euphemism, cannabis use disorder. What that means, marijuana is addictive. It's in their book. But they're not telling you that. Nobody's telling you that. We used to see these pictures when we were young. You guys probably don't see these anymore because we don't have to show them to you because you're all smart enough to know you don't smoke cigarettes. You all get that. You don't want to smoke cigarettes. Cigarette sales have plummeted. So the tobacco companies, who are not happy they can't sell you cigarettes, have come up with a new product. You guys have all seen those commercials, right? Somebody that had cancer from smoking, they keep smoking through the hole in their throat. Why do they keep smoking even after cancer? Nicotine. They're addicted to the nicotine. That's what cigarette companies want them to be, addicted so they keep buying the cigarettes. So they came up with this beautiful new product, the vape, the Juul. to sell you pure liquid nicotine. So when you see somebody vaping and acting so cool and blowing that smoke around, I want you to reflect for a second, how cool is it to be sucking on pure nicotine and getting just as addicted to that nicotine as anybody ever got addicted to smoking cigarettes? But they flavor it like bubble gum. And then they say, oh, we're not marketing this to young people. If you guys are dabbing or waxing or using the oils, you are insane. My friends who smoked weed at Parker got wasted on the weed they were smoking, which was 5% THC. My friends got truly smashed on that weed. I was there. The weed you guys are being offered, the plant you guys are being offered, is 25% potency. I've talked to adults who smoked a bunch of weed when they were younger, and I tell them that, and their eyes get huge. They can't even imagine what that much marijuana would do to somebody. If you're smoking the wax or the oils, you're getting 10 or 20 joints worth of that weed in your brains. And medical science is discovering that marijuana at those levels is a completely different drug, and it's causing brain damage. And you're looking at me, Olga Rocky, you're full of it now, you've lost me. The gummies, marketed for children. The number one opponents of marijuana legalization in this country are the emergency room doctors in the states where it's legal, because they're seeing the kids, they're seeing the people come in. I'm almost done. If you think marijuana is safe, if you think it's not harmful, I don't blame you, because you've been told that 10,000 times. But if you think that, I got a challenge for you. Educate yourselves. Do a Google search, teen brain damage marijuana, and read some of the scientific articles discussing what happens to teenagers who smoke. They're not finding brain damage in adults, because adult brains are done growing. You guys are smoking it. Teenagers, to change your brains, how they work, you may be changing how your brains grow. I'll finish up with this example. If it were lunchtime and I handed out burritos to everybody, and you opened the packages and they looked like that, would you eat them? Right? No, you wouldn't. As hungry as you were, as polite as you are, you go, Rocky, no thank you. Because you learned at 2 years old. Everybody in this auditorium learned at 2 years old, you don't eat that. A toddler would not pick that up and eat it. If you learn not to put bad food in your body at two, how could you be willing to put that crystal or the powder or whatever it is, come on, take this, take this, take this, when you know it could kill you at 15? And the only reason you're doing that is because you're not thinking. You let somebody else make the choice for you. You saw the slogan, I choose my future. I choose my future. I do not want you to have somebody else choose yours. One more example. Some of you may have a headache from listening to me talk so much. I wouldn't blame you. You go home after school and there's grandma. You complain about your headache. She goes, here, sweetie, here's some aspirin. Take them. As you're about to eat the aspirin, you look in the box and it says it expires 1955. Are you guys going to take those aspirins? No, none of you. You're going to go, wow, grandma, my headache just went away. No, thank you. And then you guys are laughing because you're tracking. Simply seeing that aspirin is old tells you it could be dangerous, you're not going to use it. When in fact, old aspirin cannot hurt you. But again, the pill or the powder or the crystal or the drink, whatever that fool is offering you at the party, could literally today kill you or steal your dreams or turn you into an addict. So, we'll leave it with this. What kind of life do you choose? 10 years ago, I went to my youngest daughter's school and I spoke. Afterwards, she drew that picture of me and gave it to me. That's a huge treasure for me. Not because she's such a talented artist, but because of all the mistakes I've made in life and all the things I think I'm doing wrong, my little girl looked at me like a hero and wanted me to know it. That's a treasure for me. The note I took from the wallet of a man I arrested right here in Carmel Valley about 6 years ago, an addict. I did not arrest him because he's a drug addict. I arrested him because of the crimes he was committing to get his drugs. There's a big difference. I hope you understand it. So I arrested him, and I went through all this stuff, and I'm talking to him. And I pulled that out of his wallet. I said, what is this? He goes, it's a note from my son. How old's your son? He goes, 6. Guys, how much pain does a 6-year-old have to be in to take out a pen and paper and write his own father that note, calling him the worst name he can think to call him? What that note really says to me is, dear dad, stop ruining my life. Dear dad, stop hurting me. I find it pathetic that a child in our society is living in that much pain. And there are many. But there's something even more pathetic than that. And the father started crying, and told me, Rocky, I want to stop hurting my son. The father knew exactly how much pain he's causing his son, and every time he tried to stop using drugs, his own brain said, oh, no, no, I don't care who you hurt, give me my drug. So, the choices you make today and tomorrow define your future. Do you choose to make choices that put you hopefully on a path where you can bring strength and joy and love to your loved ones? Or do you make choices that put you on a path to bring pain, misery, and suffering to your loved ones? It's in your hands. You guys have been great. Thank you.